Hi everyone. So today I'm going to tackle this, my old Ensoniq SQ-R module that I've had for a long time, since the 90s. Always worked good, but last time I turned it on, it had a really nasty hum. So I'm going to show you how I go about fault finding this and fixing it. So I'm absolutely no expert, but I've never had to pay anyone else to fix my gear or cars. So you can do it yourself as well, just by using your brains, referring to whatever notes you can find, and some basic pieces of test gear. So let's dive in. So this is the problem. When you turn it on, everything seems to come up okay. And when I connect MIDI and play it, it receives MIDI notes, but I just get no audio output. It doesn't matter where I put my headphone out. It just gives me this nasty hum. So just turn that down. So we're going to have an attempt at finding out where the hum's coming from and getting it working. So my first step will be looking at the power supply. So let's do that. Inside the synth, even without a schematic, there's some quick tests you can do to see what's going on. So we have our power coming in. Have to be very careful not to touch that, because in this case it's 240 coming in. But with the power disconnected, you could go through first. If you're getting no power at all, you'd check all the fuses. So just use a multimeter on the ohm setting and measure across the fuses and just check that you get closed circuit. So you should get zero on the meter. Go and test all of those first. Then you can move on. You can see you've got some test points here. TP and plus 5, so that's 5 volt. So you'd put the meter on 5 volts DC and test those points with the power connected. So again, be careful, but keep your fingers away from the live power, but 5 volts is not going to hurt you, so that part of the circuit's pretty safe. Here there's also a plus 12, which is a 12 volt line as well, and if you go through the circuit, you might find plus 5, plus 15. You just want to test that you've got voltage happening at those components. And also on these op amps, these transistors, you can also check out what the number of it is, do a search on Google, find the PDF document, which will show you how they're wired, and you can find out what the power should be coming in and what should be going out, so you can measure that as well. So they're the basic power checks to see that the circuit is actually active and getting the power that it needs before you start to dive a bit deeper into finding what's actually wrong with the circuit. So here we are inside looking around. This is where the power comes in. So this is obviously all the power supply circuit here, which we know is working. When we come across to here, we have a battery. I've measured that. Should be 3 volts. It's 2.5, so that's low. But that won't be causing the audio problem. That will need to be changed, though. Otherwise, we'll lose our backup memory. This is the audio circuit. These are my audio outputs. That's how I know it's the audio circuit. And here we have some transistors that are responsible for the audio amplifier. And we also have this transistor here. So check this out. I'm measuring across this 7915 transistor, and you'll see I get a complete short out on the crow between the center pin and the outside pin. Whereas if I take a brand new 7915 and I connect it the same way, you will see I actually get a knee on the transistor. Connect that again. So we have the center pin, outside pin. So that transistor is working. So I have to presume, having also measured it with the multimeter, that there's a direct short between the base collector and emitter on that transistor. So I'm going to swap that out and see if that fixes the problem. So after swapping out that 7915 op amp here, we still have a hum and no signal. So I'm thinking it might be this capacitor. I've checked it, it's 0 ohms. So I'm gonna pull that out and check it against a good capacitor. It's 22 microfarad, 25 volt. So now I swapped out this transistor, but still the same hum. So then I measured the one that I took out of circuit, and that definitely was faulty. But then the next thing is, I don't have a schematic for this, so I can't check, but this capacitor was this one here, which is a 25 volt, 22 microfarad. which was connected to that transistor, and I measured across that, and it was open circuit, 0 ohms. So that means that that capacitor is gone. It's broken. So pulled that out, put a electrolytic in there, 22 microfarad, 25 volt, and let's see what happens when we turn it on. So no hum. And if we play some notes on a MIDI keyboard, there we go. So that was the problem. The transistor was gone. Maybe the capacitor went first and took out the transistor. But anyway, those two have been replaced. Very easy repair, and they're done. Synth is now working, no noise. What I'll do next is go through, swap out the battery for a new 3-volt battery, and also go and replace some of the other capacitors as well. I'll actually pull out this circuit board and put the capacitor in circuit properly. This is just to check. So there we go. Pretty quick fix. So let's try that bung capacitor on my leakage tester and see what the results are. So I've got it connected. Let's turn it on. See if it charges. No, not looking good. So yeah, that capacitor is definitely faulty. Just to show you what a good capacitor should look like, here we go, turn it on, charge, bang, there we go. So there you go, that's the difference between a bung and a good capacitor. Okay, I've been going through the circuit, checking capacitors. I found a couple here, which are 22 microfarad, 35 volts, that was similar style of capacitor to the faulty one before. So I've pulled them out and swapped them just because I don't trust them. But actually they tested okay. And one thing I want to show you when you're checking capacitors is you'll see here I've got another one which I've pulled out of circuit to test, and it tested okay using my capacitor meter. But if you're using a multimeter, let me show you something that's interesting. If I go to test it, so I connect, I'm on my ohm scale in the meter, and I connect the negative lead to the negative and the positive to the positive and connect it, and you'll see I get nothing on the meter. So no change at all. So that would seem to show that it's actually open circuit and dead. But actually what it is it's charged. So in order to measure it, I have to actually discharge it. And the way you can do that is you can connect one lead to the other, which is a very brutal way to do it. It's quite harsh on the capacitor. So that will actually short it out and bring it back down again, and then you can test it properly. So I'll just show you that. So let's check again just to show you. Here we go. Got nothing happening on the meter there. Just to show you that it is working, if I connect to ground, you'll see that I get 0 ohms, which is what you want. So it means there's no resistance when I connect the negative to the negative. But again, when I check the positive lead on the capacitor, nothing happening, no measurement. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to short it out, which will actually discharge it for me. So I'll connect the positive lead with an alligator clip to earth. Bang. That's all you need to do. Just touch it on. And now I'll be able to test it properly. So now when I connect my multimeter and test it on the ohms rating scale, you should see it increase in resistance until it reaches its maximum resistance, which will look like it's open circuit. So let's go. Here it goes, increasing in resistance, bang, overload. So now that that's reached overload, the capacitor is charged. And when I, again, take my connector off and try to retest it, it won't let me test it. It'll look like it's open circuit. So that's a really important thing about capacitors. To check them properly, you really need to discharge them, which often means shorting them out. Using my capacitance leakage tester, which I'll put a link to below, which I have over on the right-hand side here, which I've been showing you in these videos, that actually has a discharge function, so that will safely discharge it rather than just short-circuiting the capacitor, which can be bad for them. But anyway, just to show you that, that capacitor, I've tested it, it's okay, so I'm not going to go and swap it out. There's no point. So you don't need to randomly go through and just throw out every capacitor, even if it looks a bit old. It might be perfectly fine, and you can save yourself some money. On the other hand, if you don't want to have to open the thing up for years, and you've got capacitors ready to go, then you could, of course, just swap them out. But you might want to keep the ones you pull out as safety spares in case you ever need a capacitor and you don't have the right value. So there you go. My board's all screwed back in. I've gone through and checked and replaced capacitors that needed replacing, and then just checked to make sure all the cables are reconnected properly. The battery is a fresh battery that's in. Make sure all your power connectors are connected and check it before you put the case on. So let's do that now. Okay, so we've been through, replaced bad capacitors and basically given it a bit of a cleanup. Now we're just going to check it before we put it all back together. So let's hear how it sounds. No more buzz, which is nice. First patch is Mystic, which is the factory preset. And I'm just going to play a bit of that. Let's have a listen to how it sounds. Nice. Yep, that's the SQ-R. So I really like this synth, actually, and I've used it for lots of little things over the years. It's the rack version of the SQ-1 keyboard. And, yeah, really nice. And Ensoniq stuff's not made anymore, so it's a nice little bit of history. So I might hang on to this one. So thanks for watching, and I hope this has helped give you an idea of how you can go through and fault find problems without needing a schematic.